Welcome to this video on the Shih from the tabletop role-playing game Kindred of the East. The Shih are the demon hunters of Asia, wandering warriors in the tradition of the Jia or the Ronin. But unlike their more notable Western counterparts, the Shih do not seek to exterminate the supernatural. Rather, their purpose is to punish those who stray from the path that heaven has assigned to them. Even if the Jade Emperor has turned his face from Earth, the Shih still carry out his will. But without further ado, the Shih. The founder of the Shih was a man named Wan Kung-yi, born in the waning years of the Shang Dynasty. The Shang had risen to power with the aid of the fallen warrior sages of heaven, the Wan Kuei, who lent their power to the emperors and their chieftains in exchange for sacrifices of blood and jade. Yi was born into a family of warriors and noblemen, but had the soul of a dreamer. Yi learned the arts of war and leadership from his family, but his father did not believe that Yi possessed the qualities of a leader. However, he was attentive and inquisitive, so his father sent him among the people as a tax collector. It was a worthy assignment, and curious Yi could learn more in one journey than a dozen other men. However, Yi was far too observant, and while his father was a good and wise man, he was also in the grip of the Wan Kuei, just like all who held power in the Middle Kingdom. Failure to obey the demons meant destruction, not only for Yi's father, but for his entire family. As Yi traveled, he saw Shen preying on the people, villagers shut up in their huts, praying that neither Shapechanger nor Shade came to devour them in the night. His father's soldiers did nothing to help the people or protect them. Yi reported back what he had seen to his father and requested an army to scour the villages and the wilderness. But his father took him to his private chambers and explained to him who the true rulers of the Middle Kingdom were, and neither he nor any of the other lords could raise a hand against the Wan Kuei. Wan Kung-yi, for the first time in his life, raised his voice against his father and cursed him for a coward. To his sorrow, Lord Wan had to punish his son, so he exiled Yi from the land, permitting him only a wagon, his armor, and his weapons. Yi, in anger and sadness, left his home and began a journey to find the power to fight against the Wan Kuei. Yi journeyed north to join with the Cho, who fought against the Shang. On a few occasions, Yi met with the Shen in battle, but barely escaped with his life. One night, Yi came upon a temple, under attack by fearsome goblin spiders. His body was aching and his spirit was nearly drained, but he would not leave the sages of the temple to be devoured. Yi resolved that this would be a good place to die, drew his sword, and rode into battle. And it was there, in that battle, while Yi was exhausted and empty from his trials, that his chi awakened. The world seemed to slow to a standstill, and his sword cut through the goblin spiders without breaking or even chipping. By the end, the goblin spiders were dead, and Yi collapsed, wounded and on the cusp of death. The sages carried Yi into their temple and healed his body and spirit. While Yi convalesced, the sages discussed their teachings with him, which cleared his mind and cooled his angry heart. He realized that what his father did was the right path. The lives of his people were worth more than a warrior's pride. What's more, Yi accepted that the Shen had their place in the natural order of the world, just as the storms and the droughts did. After his body healed, Yi meditated for one full year on what he had learned. Yi then approached the eldest sage and asked him, if the Shen are unstoppable, why was he able to kill them a year before? The sage replied that some things simply are. Every day must have a night, every spring an autumn, and every yang a yin. Yi was a virtuous and just man, and therefore he was meant to succeed. Yi considered this and said that he was but one man against a host of Shen. The eldest replied that he must find other virtuous men to aid him. Yi then smiled and asked if the eldest and his sages were virtuous men. The eldest did not answer for a long time, because what ye asked for would be difficult for him and his followers. But finally, the eldest nodded, followed by the other monks. Ye and his allies would become the first of the Shih. For a decade, Ye and his companions built up their strength. They fought against the Shin and learned how best to defeat them. Through meditation and prayer, they learned how to resist the tricks and illusions of the Shin. While many fell in battle, they were soon replaced by those who had lost loved ones to the Shin's schemes and predations. As the numbers of Shih grew, several other temples opened themselves to accommodate these new demon hunters. As Ye wandered the Middle Kingdom, he met a woman named Hing O, who was kin to the water spirits. From her, he learned that not all Shin were evil. She taught him how to distinguish between Shin who fulfilled their duties to heaven and those who had stepped out of their place. Ye asked Hing O's father for her hand in marriage. While Ye was off playing house, the Cho went to war against the Shang, lending their shaman to assist the Shih in their hunts. The Shin finally took notice that they were being actively preyed on by mortals and retaliated through their Shang puppets. However, others joined the fight against the Shang. The Cho's anger reached its breaking point when word reached them that the Shang Emperor was merely a puppet of the Shin. Wan Kung Yi never forgot his family, or his father, who he had judged too hastily and too harshly. He finally decided to return home, to the heart of the Shang territory, with 50 of his disciples who insisted on going with him. During his road back, Yi met numerous Shin, however he only destroyed 7 of them. When his followers asked him his reasons, he replied that the Shin followed their nature, and so long as they did not cause too much harm, he had no reason to punish them. However, the 7 he destroyed were gluttons and sadists, and for that, they deserved to perish. When Yi reached his birthplace, he found his father's palace burned to the ground. As for his father and brothers, they were slain and their bodies desecrated. The women and children of his family were sacrificed to feed the Wan Kuei. Wan Kung Yi, who believed that he had found peace, was gripped by a fury so terrible that it could have split the heavens. No Shin was safe from Yi. Wan Kuei, Hong Yokai, Kamui, Hisien, they all met death at his hands. But Yi's frenzy caught the attention of one creature that knew neither fear nor death. Kung Kung, the celestial dragon who once knocked loose the pillars of heaven and flooded the world. The dragon calmed Yi's anger with his wisdom, then carried him up in his paw into the heavens. The Wan Kuei of Shang had become fearful of the Shih, and their fear was so great that they met near Kunlun and there brokered a deal with their hated foes, the Yama Kings. The Yama Kings demanded an awful payment, the blood and souls of thousands of innocents, in exchange for their aid against the Shih and their Cho allies. But when the sacrifice was done, 10 suns blazed in the sky above the Middle Kingdom, scorching only the lands of the Cho. The Cho retaliated by marshaling their armies and attacking the Shang. The common people of Shang, seeing the 10 suns as an auspicious omen, rallied to the Cho and joined their fight against the Shang army. For 3 months, the Wan Kuei and the Yama Kings exulted in their power, as mortals and Shin alike suffered beneath the 10 suns that never set. Corpses filled dried riverbeds. At Anyang, King Wu Wang of Cho met Emperor Shang Dijin in personal combat. Wu bested the emperor and left him to burn inside of his palace, a funeral pyre fit for the last of the Shang. Yet, there are some who claim that Dijin rose from his fiery grave and wanders the earth, even in the modern nights. Whether he does so as a wraith or one of the Wan Kuei, none know for certain. But as the Shang and Cho armies fought, Kung Kung flew through the sky with Wan Kung Yi astride his back. The dragon's roar struck fear in the hearts of the bravest men, and where the dragon passed, thunder cracked and cool rain fell from his scales. Yi wielded a new weapon, a bow crafted from the Tree of Immortality, and a quiver filled with arrows made of white jade. Yi fired 9 arrows, one at each of the false suns. As he loosed each bolt, he called down a curse upon the Yama Kings and the Wan Kuei. Each arrow struck true, and 9 of the magical suns blinked out of the sky until only the true sun remained. The battle stopped as mortals and Shen looked up in amazement. Kung Kung landed on the battlefield to allow Yi to dismount. The celestial dragon then flew away, never to be seen by mortal eyes again. It was only then that the cost of breaking the Wan Kuei's curse became apparent. Yi had not only burned his chi, but his very life essence. Every arrow he fired cost him a decade. His handsome face was creased and lined as deep as sword cuts, his limbs robbed of their strength, but his will remained. The Shang soldiers turned upon their Shen allies, and together with the Cho and the Shi, drove them from the Middle Kingdom, at least for a time. When the war was done, Wu Wang was declared first emperor of the Cho dynasty. He offered Yi wealth and treasure, but Yi told him that he was soon to be reunited with his father and would have no need of either wealth or weapons. However, he selected several items offered to him by the new emperor and gave them to his 5 children, all of whom were powerful Shi in their own right. When the celebrations had finished, Yi spoke to his followers for one last time. He asked that they carry on his duty to protect the world and the people from demons and spirits that neglected their duties to heaven. He instructed them to follow his children and learn from them, for he would be with them to guide them. The Shi each stepped forward and pledged to carry on in their master's path and to follow his children, and sealed their oaths with blood. By the time the last Shi made his vow, the ground was dark and wet, soaked with freely offered blood. Yi closed his eyes. Through their sacrifice of blood, Yi inflicted one last curse upon the Wan Kuei, so that they could never use heaven again as a weapon against the people. He cursed them to rot under the light of the sun, to wither away under the eye of heaven. When he finished, Wan Kung Yi, the excellent archer, the first of the Shi, smiled and breathed his last. People have since wondered how Yi could wield such amazing power. There have been Shi since the excellent archer who were mighty and terrifying to the Shen, but none have ever managed to match Yi. The answer is that Wan Kung Yi was awakened. He possessed an avatar like any other mage and used it, subconsciously, to not only focus his chi, but make it easier for his followers to learn how to use their own chi. The Shi grew in power during the 2 centuries following Yi's death. They built fortresses and schools of their own to teach disciples. They became so numerous that some took to calling themselves the Celestial Army, and began a campaign to exterminate all of the Shen in violation of the command of Yi to destroy only those Shen who failed to fulfill their duty to heaven. The mightiest fortress of the Celestial Army was located in the Kunlun Mountains. The Celestial Army claimed a number of trophies from the Shen they destroyed, including the writings of the Wan Kuei. Some hunters who stayed true to the command of Yi studied the writings and even learned Kaja, the forbidden script of the Wan Kuei, to read the most ancient of their scrolls. While the commanders of the Celestial Army sought to increase their power in the Cho Dynasty, the Shi learned how to better fight demons, ironically, by using some of the techniques of their greatest enemy. Finally, the commanders of the Celestial Army gave the wandering Shi a choice, either join with them fully or depart from their company. The Shi would not fight against the Celestial Army. They gathered the most important of their books and teachings and left. 1 month later, the Celestial Army's fortress exploded, as the mountain it was built on experienced an unexpected volcanic eruption. And while there is a volcanic field in the Kunlun Mountains, this particular catastrophe was not natural, but rather the work of the Wan Kuei, and perhaps even the Yama Kings. Today there are no longer Shi monasteries or schools. Meetings between Shi are rare, and typically coincidental. Most believe that when 2 or more Shi gather, it is because an enemy will soon reveal themselves that neither could fight alone. Of course, when a group of Shi gather in any locale for too long, the Shen rightly get nervous. Kuei-jin mandarins warn their subordinates that there is an equal chance that a Shi may sit down with them for tea, or cut their heads off. Younger Shih have formed tentative bands of hunters for support and companionship, usually where the Kuei-jin are strongest. This is not a practice that most experienced Shih support, but thus far, no harm appears to have come from it. But they are wary that these young Shih will repeat the follies of the Celestial Army. The watchword of the Shih is vengeance. A Shih sacrifices everything for the sake of revenge against the Shen who have wronged them. There are no part-time Shih. There are no corporate sponsors, no church. The Shih live from what they take from their fallen enemies and the generosity of their few allies. A handful of Shih families persist into the modern knights. However, the Shih typically draw their disciples from those who have been victimized by the Shen, of which there are sadly a great many. Kuei-jin, shapeshifters, vampires, demons, and other things regard humans as either food or toys. As to the survivors, the general attitude of the Shen is, so what? And so, the Shih emerge to exact justice from the Shen that no one else can. The Shih do not actively recruit, yet when a man swears revenge, they offer to aid him in that goal, but make it clear in advance that he will pay a heavy price before he ever even gets the chance to exact his revenge. Most of the Shih's recruits are children, orphaned by the fangs and claws of the Shen. The Shih try to give these children to their nearest living relative, but those without kin usually begin training as soon as they've shed their last tears for their families. The most important tool of the Shih is his mind. The strength of the Shen is not in their muscles or claws, it is in their ability to twist and pervert the minds and souls of mortals to their purpose. So a Shih master will heat, hammer, and cool his disciples' resolve like a blacksmith working iron. Meditation, exercise, and riddles shape the mind, and ingrain the Shih with an understanding that, as terrifying as the Shen may be, they can always be killed. Of course, the Shih take their training even deeper, controlling bodily functions through mental discipline and mastery of internal qi. A Shih's body is also as hard as his mind. Miles of running, mountain climbing, and conditioning leave Shih bodies as solid as steel, but covered in scars, calluses, and other trophies of the merciless Shih training methods handed down to them from ancient days. Fists and feet are toughened against posts, trees, and rocks. Every day ends in blood and torn flesh, if the disciple is lucky, broken bones if he is not, and death if he is truly unlucky. But as brutal as the Shih's lessons are, they are necessary. The Shen would inflict far worse than death on them if they failed in their training. And Shih occasionally hunt down the Shen who slew the friends and families of their failed disciples, to keep the vows of vengeance they made, and to release themselves from any obligation to those who proved unworthy of the title of Shih. One solution to this problem is found in the Shih's mentorship of children, to whom the option of quitting is simply never given. On one hand, children make better students. Their minds have not yet crystallized with cynicism against the existence of the supernatural. They are better able to adapt to the harsh training necessary to become a Shih. They believe and gain strength from the belief in their own power. However, a child who is raised as a Shih will almost never be able to enjoy a normal life, or even really understand it. A decade or two of brutal training, and human weaknesses can be more alien than the depredations of the Wan Kuei. A young Shih might wonder, why stop at killing Hangya Yokai, when heroin dealers are much closer and kill far more people? A warrior trained to stop a rampaging lupine has little to fear from slow, clumsy gunmen. And this is why Shih masters constantly remind their disciples that their primary duty is to keep watch against the Shen, not to judge mortals for their failings. This doesn't stop a Shih from occasionally breaking gangsters' bones or tossing them out of very high windows. Not only is it good exercise and a public service, but criminals usually keep cash on hand. The life of a Shih is perilous, both physically and mentally. There are too many Shen for any Shih to destroy, even if they wanted to, and seeing beyond the bamboo screen into the world of demons and monsters takes its toll on even the most honorable Shih. Despite the example of Wan Kun-yi, the excellent archer, Shih had been known to fall prey to bitterness, despair, and even hatred. The Shih study a variety of martial arts styles and techniques. At the core of every Shih's training is Mochi Kung Fu, or Devil Judgment Style. The Mochi Kung Fu techniques have been specifically designed to counter the attacks of Shin and exploit their weaknesses. For example, many Hanga Yokai, despite their fearsome war forms, are still living animals. By striking the sensitive nerve ganglia of their noses or snouts, a Shih can disorient them long enough to finish the creatures off. Similarly, a Shih can focus a strike against the jawbones of the Shin, shattering their faces and depriving them of their fangs as a weapon. Using knowledge of Qi flow and pressure points, a Shih can strike a Kuei-jin in precise spots on the body to disrupt their Qi until they are able to repair the damage. At a more advanced level and with the use of a weapon, a Shih can strip a Shin of their supernatural power source, whether it's Qi, Rage, or Quintessence. Speaking of Qi, what sets apart the Shih from other mortals is that, through rigorous training, the Shih has access to their Qi. Qi is the very essence of life and existence. The Shin, whether they are Kuei-jin, Hanga Yokai, Kamui, Hixian, or Qin Ta, they fight and kill to steal Qi, or secure access to the natural reservoirs of Qi known as dragon's nests. Qi is more valuable than any gold or silver, but the use of Qi is a double-edged sword. A Shih, as a mortal, cannot possess Qi in the same quantity as their enemies, nor expend it as freely. Every mortal has a limited amount of Qi. Most of the time, there will be a balance between yin and yang, but certain people suffer from Qi imbalances. The Shih can use their precious Qi to power certain rituals they call Qiao, or bridges. The Shih have developed 9 of these Qiao in their 3,000-year history. The Qiao of the Yi Shin, or the Bridge of the Celestial Gods, uses prayer strips infused with Qi to hinder or harm Shin. This Qiao may be used as a kind of warning shot to Shin, to paralyze them, to cause Shin to burst into sacred flame, or to strike the Shin with heaven's own thunder. The Qiao of the Mo Kung, or the Bridge of the Devil Fighter, increases the speed, strength, stamina, and perception of the Shih in order to match the abilities of the Shin. The Qiao of the Yuan, the Bridge of the Jade Harmony, defends the Shih against the mental tricks of the Shin. At its simplest, the Shih can detect Shin who are not actively concealing themselves, determine when someone is lying or possessed, communicate with the denizens of the Yin and Yang realms, or open a pathway between the spirit world and the Middle Kingdom. The Qiao of the Feng, or the Bridge of the Phoenix, is a simple art, but a potentially fatal one. The Shih uses their Yin Qi to force bones to reconnect, nerves and muscles and sinews to knit back together, and overall heal the body. It essentially trades life force to rebuild the physical form. This Qiao can be used to shut off the pain receptors of the Shih's body, to regenerate wounds quickly, and, at its zenith, a Shih can restore themselves from fatal injuries and even reverse the aging process. The Qiao of the Shih, the Bridge of the Serpent, turns a Shih's hands and feet into weapons more lethal than any sword, spear, or bow. This Qiao teaches a Shih to compress their Yang Qi to unleash a flurry of blows in the time it takes the human eye to blink, to harden their fingers until they are each a spear tip, to strike and harm incorporeal spirits, to harden their bodies until they are tougher than steel, to tear apart enemies with a series of precise strikes at their vital points. And you are obligated, at the height of this art, to say, at the end of a series of strikes, Omae wa mo, shinderu. Anyway, the Qiao of the Qian, the Bridge of the Mirror, not only protects a Shih from attempts to tamper with his Qi, but allows the Shih to strip Qi from enemies as well. A Shih may use Yang Qi to build armor over his own life force to redirect supernatural attacks hurled at him back at the attacker, to block the ability of a Shen to steal Qi, and to steal Qi from Shen for the Shi's immediate use. The Qiao of the Long Ling, the bridge of the Dragon Ruler, imposes the will of the Shih on his enemies, intimidating them as the dragons would. A Shih may channel his Yin Qi to intimidate his enemies, to weaken their resolve, to force one of the restless dead to be trapped within their worst memories, to command a spirit to perform a single, simple task, or to impose absolute terror on all enemies who see him. The Qiao of Ming, the Bridge of Dreams, restores the mind and spirit of a Shih, much as the Qiao of the Feng restores the body. A Shih may rebalance his Qi at will, restore his willpower, cleanse his mind of traumatic memories and addictions, and even exercise his own spirit of demonic influence. The Qiao of the Zhu Mao, the Bridge of the Resilient Cat, enhances the movements of a Shih. A Shih can move with perfect silence, run across the surfaces of water, and balance on the leaves of trees. At higher levels, Zhu Mao can be used to redirect the movements of Qi. For example, a Shih can redirect an opponent's momentum to throw them 20 or more feet away, to channel the force of a blow down into the ground, or stop any object mid-movement, including bullets. And that was the lore of the Shih. Now, there are some people who think that World of Darkness is supposed to be all doom, despair, and drama all the time. But I do love me some anime. I freely admit it. I like my chop sake Hong Kong movies and wuxia. So, Demon Hunter X holds a special place in my heart. For historical games, there are dozens of wuxia and chanbara films that capture the aesthetic of the lone warrior battling against the forces of the unrighteous, such as Legend of the Condor Heroes and Lone Wolf and Cub. As for more modern Shih, Demon City Shinjuku is as close to the perfect aesthetic as I can think of, with Taito Monogatari coming in a close second. But that's all I have for the Shih. Until next time.